Julie is with us on the show today. Midge is coming to Falmouth soon, actually. It's not very far away, is it? October the 1st, you're down in Falmouth.
I am, yeah. Autumn.
Yeah? Yeah. Well, you were only down here a few months ago, weren't you, anyway?
I love Cornwall. What can I tell you? It's home from home for me. It's like Scotland, but with sunshine sometimes. You know, it's glorious. I spend a lot of time in Cornwall, so any chance I get, I'm there. And Falmouth's fabulous. It's a beautiful place.
And you were at the Minac last time you were down, weren't you, in the open air theatre?
Yeah, how lucky it didn't rain. How lucky. I mean, it's cold. You know, it does get a bit cold. But then again, I think anyone in the UK going to an outside, you know, an open air gig who didn't bring a jumper and, you know, wellies and, you know, a hat and an umbrella would be, you know, insane. But, you know, the audience at the Minac are just so prepared for whatever the weather throws at them. And it was glorious. It's always a really cool, intimate evening.
You've played the Princess Pavilion before, because I've seen you play down there. So I know you've played down there before. So it's not a venue you're unfamiliar with.
Yeah. No, I know it well.
Yeah. And you obviously you've mentioned that you love Cornwall so much, because you kind of live... You're not too far away. You're in the southwest. You're about, 3 hours away or so, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm in the Bath area.
Do you come down here as a just on holiday any time and just cruise around? Or is it when you're down here, are you normally playing?
No, a holiday. My children have been brought up in, you know, Harlan Bay and, you know, all of that stuff up on the north coast. You know, around Padstow and stuff like that. So it's kind of Padstow in the summer is a bit like Bath by the Sea. It's just, you know, you keep bumping into people, you know, yeah. And the neighbours. But, you know, we absolutely love it. So we've been going there since they were tiny on the beaches. So for me, you know, a British holiday is great. And getting on a plane is something I do for a job, for a living. You know, I'm on and off planes all the time. So we do the odd, you know, holiday abroad or the odd big holiday or whatever. But, you know, the instant hit for me is just, you know, the exciting thing is jumping in the car and just driving down there and spending a bit of time chilling out.
Yeah. Well, you're playing Princess Pavilion October the 1st. What does this show consist of?
Well, it's a fairly specific thing. I've got a couple of young multi-instrumentalists with me to make me sound good. A couple of guys who are a band in their own right, who I know that you've met.
Yeah. The
Indie Electric Company, who are I think Devon or Dorset. Based, I'm not quite sure. They're kind of from the West Country anyway, and they're lovely guys. And these guys had supported me for a few gigs, because we tend to, you know, open up the support slots doing shows to new up and coming artists to give them a leg up. And Indie Electric Company came along a few times, and I was really impressed with the playing. I mean, the songs and stuff were great, but as instrumentalists, they're just outstanding. And we approached them. It gave me the idea of maybe looking at an album that I recorded and released 20 years ago, an album called Breathe, which is a very organic sounding record anyway. I mean, it still had synthesizers and guitars and stuff, but
it's
had
like all, Celtic, though.
My Scottish roots were coming out on that album. And the album itself went through hell to try and be released. You know, I was A&R'd to death.
Oh, A&R'd, God, really?
Is the A&R guys, the artist and repertoire guys, who say, well, Midge, you know, we've signed you, but maybe this time you shouldn't do it in your own studio. And I'd say, yeah, okay. And maybe you shouldn't produce it yourself. And I say, okay. And maybe you shouldn't use the same musicians you always use. And I say, okay. You know, and maybe you shouldn't, you know. And I said, well, you know, do you want me to sing it? You know, do you want to get somebody else to do that as well? So anyway, we made this album, and it came, and when I gave it to the record company, it sat in a shelf for over a year because they weren't in a position to put it out. And then when it came out, it was the worst selling record ever made for 2 years, until a certain watch company picked up the title track and used it on a TV commercial. And it became absolutely huge because of this. It was amazing.
That's actually incredible when something like that happens, isn't it? How big a song can be for 30 seconds on a TV commercial?
Well, it's unbelievable because, you know, luckily when I saw the advert, they ask you first, and I saw the advert they wanted to put out, and it was a beautifully shot piece of film. It was absolutely stunning. It wasn't just, you know, packed shots of stuff all over it. It was a beautiful shot about what you could do in a minute, you know, as a baby born and people winning a race and, you know, all these lovely, yeah, magical moments. And the music just worked brilliantly with it. So I thought, well, you know, if someone maybe gets to hear it and decides to look up what the music is, you know, they might discover the album. You know, lo and behold, all the radio stations, it started in Italy, all the radio stations in Italy were getting phoned up by, you know, people who had seen this advert saying, what is this? And they had no idea. And it turns out that they... radio stations had had the album in their libraries for 2 years and never played it. So it was the best way anyone could discover your music, because I had no baggage, I had no past. Yeah. You know, there was no ageism about it, no hairism about it, you know. all of the things, all the periphery of music that people deemed so important were gone. All they heard was this piece of music that they fell in love with, and that was a great way for someone to find it.
Were you proud of the album when you delivered it to the record company?
Yeah, of course. You know, I don't finish something that I'm not at that moment in time 100% happy with. So I gave this album that I really did think was interesting, and having, you know, having been poked with a stick in, you know, many ways, I my hackles were up, so I made something that I was really proud of, just to show these people, and so I was very proud of the thing, and when it failed initially, you get really despondent about it. You think, well, what's the point of doing another one that nobody's going to like and no one's ever going to hear? And then this thing happened, and you think, oh wow, okay, so good music will find, you know, its way to the surface eventually.
I was just looking up the chart success, and it reached number 95 when it was released.
Yeah, that's better than I thought it did. Yeah, well,
but,
you know,
what I don't understand is, where would the watch company, where would they get the idea to use a track that isn't popular in the first place?
There was a fan in Italy whose job it was to put music together, an agent. He worked for an agency who put music together with commercials. And he bought the album the day it came out, and he loved it, and he thought it was an absolute sin that this would never be heard. And he's the one who took it to the watch company and said, look, this is what you should be listening to. And the watch company, once they heard it, fell in love with it. So I'm quite right that you put something out there, someone somewhere, if you write a good, honest song, someone somewhere will be touched by it, and amazing things can happen.
I've just noticed it was released on my birthday as well, the single.
See, it was, and it was written for you?
There we are. Shall we play it then?
Absolutely.
All right, here it is. With every week. Midge Ure is with us on the show today. Midge is coming to Falmouth on October the 1st, down at the Princess Pavilion. And it's kind of a special show because you're playing a lot from Breathe, aren't you, with the Indie Electric Company as your...
I am. I've decided to play the entire album, but obviously I'm not stupid. I act like it sometimes, but I realise that not everyone will know the Breathe album because it scraped to 95.
95, yes, I think we mentioned it.
Realise that not that many people might know the album. The hardcore fans certainly do. And of course, you've got to understand as well that when people come to see you perform live, they usually come in couples, which means that one of them is maybe into what you do and the other one's going there because they've been dragged along. So you've got to think, well, what will they know? They might not know this album. So you've got to think about the other songs that will, you know, boost their evening for them. So we start with songs that people will know and recognise. We go into the Breathe album and then we finish with a bunch of songs that people will recognise. So, you know, and the interesting thing is for me, the feedback I've had about the Breathe album from people who had never heard it was incredibly positive, because it's very diverse. It's a beautiful, textural, you know, album full of, you know, hopefully lovely songs.
Let me pick up on the fact that you've just said that there'll be songs that people know, and one of those is Vienna. Right?
Yeah.
Which is, I would imagine, quite difficult to play with a mandolin, a violin, and what, a guitar?
Yeah. it's not that difficult, because I realise, because I've been doing it solo acoustic for quite a long time now, because I don't think I'd be allowed out of a venue if I don't play it.
No.
And I realised that, I thought, well, I don't know how you do this. I don't know how you can get away without the drum beat and the synthesised bass and the piano, the haunting piano, and the viola solo, you know, all of that. And then I realised that people fill the gaps in with their heads. You know, they listen to it and they can hear the other parts around it. So when I do it with the two guys, it's got all the flavour and essence and atmospherics of the original record, but it's done with just three instruments. And of course, you know, Joseph, the violinist, is just outstanding, absolutely amazing.
Well, funny you should mention that, because when they came in, as we had them on when you were down at the Minac, I said, listen, you've got to play a bit of Vienna. You have to play a bit of the violin solo. So this is what they came up with. I can hear the rest of the instruments.
Well, you can. You can. Your brain kind of fills in the holes, fills in the gaps. You know, and that's just fantastic. I'm really pleased they played that. And I hope I get my royalties.
Yes.
Because I am Scottish, of course.
What was that, 32 seconds? Yeah, there we are. When you're playing Breathe, as we've mentioned, where does that sit for you personally? I'm not talking about commercially now. For you personally, where does it sit on your top 10 of your own albums?
I think it's up there. I mean, it's in the top, maybe the top three, because it was a moment when I was challenged, as I explained to you. I was challenged by the record company. I was kind of limited. It took me out of my comfort zone to go and let someone else can steer the ship, as it were. You know, someone else was in charge of the thing. And of course, you know, you work with an American producer, and it's someone I chose. I found this guy, and he was great. But, you know, having someone go, yeah, not sure, can you sing that again? You think, what? You know, what, who are you talking? Do you know who I, you know, all of that stuff. And then you think, hold on a second, he's got a point. So you think about it, and sometimes you need that little bit of constraint and that little bit of pushing and manipulating now and again. And I learned an awful lot from it, actually.
Well, it's been absolutely fabulous to talk to you, Mitch. Thanks ever so much for indulging me in my Ultravox. I am going to finish up with one more from the early days, if I may. I'm not sure which one I want to play. I love Passionate Reply.
Wow.
Yeah, I know. I love Waiting.
That's all the B-sides.
Yeah, I know.
Did
I
you
know.
Not like the A-sides?
I did tell you I was a fan. Passing Strangers, obviously, is one of my favourites, I think. I'm going to go for one of the more commercial ones, I think, because there'll be people out there going, I wasn't into the B-sides at all. So let's do Reap the Wild Wind.
Fantastic.
Because you were, Ultravox were on a bit of a high at this point, I think, in your career, weren't you?
We were, you know, we'd a lovely, you know, 3 or 4 years of experimenting and doing whatever. I mean, again, we had no constraints. We didn't stick to the 3-minute pop single. We didn't stick to all the old adages of, you know, open up with the chorus and all of that.
Yeah.
Well, you know, you listen to Reap the Wild Wind, the first minute and a half is instrumental.
Yeah, it's a brilliant tune, and it's been great to talk to you. Absolute pleasure.
That was fun. I enjoyed that. That was great. And lovely to hear those. just the songs that you're talking about. I'm thinking Passionate Reply. That was, I enjoyed that. I liked that one.
We did that
in a day. We were on tour in America, and we needed a B-side like you did.
Yeah.
And you'd get the phone call from the record company saying, well, we can't put the single out without a B-side. So on a day off, we booked a studio in Miami somewhere and went in, and we came out with that after a day with no song written. We just went in and did it. And it's one of those ones that people still talk about now, you know.
Yeah, it's a brilliant tune. I love it. And right. Waiting as well. Fantastic.
Yeah.
And I remember buying the clear vinyl of Visions in Blue, and I had a French exchange student over and got her to translate the front cover for me.
Oh, right. God, I don't even remember the front cover.
Yeah,
it was all written on script.
Yeah, I know. It's very sad, isn't it? It's been wonderful to talk to you anyway. Thanks very much for coming.
Absolute pleasure.